I'm Bret Victor. This is Sean Douglas. I'm going to begin with some background on what communal computing means and the RealTalk system that was built at my lab, and the biotech work that Sean and I have been doing in RealTalk, and how we think that points the way to the science lab of the future, which is what we're currently trying to build. So RealTalk is a computing environment, an operating system, for working with real people in the real world. So instead of everyone being on laptops, you work with computational stuff that's just out on the table that everyone can gather around and get their hands on while looking each other in the eye. And the way this works is there's a bunch of projectors and cameras up in the ceiling, so anything on the table can be brought to life as a computational thing. You can make programs that run on it, and programs themselves are just things on the table. So this lets you work with computational models in your hands. You can think with your hands, you can spread out, you can take as much space as you need to explore complex concepts and complex data. And one of the main reasons that you want to be working out in the physical world is that's where the people are. So you can gather around a table and have a conversation where there's programs and data on the table. Anybody can reach in and try out different data, change the program, and have a discussion that's grounded in facts and reality. And it's not just the one magic table, it's the walls, it's the floors, the entire building is the computer, and you walk in and you're immersed in this computational space. And what you do in that space is you make programs. You don't use apps from vendors. Everybody makes their own computational tools for themselves in collaboration with others. And you learn to do this by immersion because you're in this environment where you're just surrounded by programs. Programs are everywhere. You're constantly holding them and looking at them and handling them. And you're surrounded by people that are building programs out in the open where everybody else can see what they're doing. So it's like working in a wood shop or a communal kitchen. Everybody's learning from everybody else all the time. And this extends all the way down to the operating system itself. Here it is. There is no code base in GitHub. It's just real stuff in the world that everybody can see and get their hands on and live edit at any time. And we built it ourselves in exactly this way, gathered around a table, immersed in computation. This is how we do our day-to-day work, not on laptops. So this is the real deal, and there's nothing else in the world like this. And you can't invent something like this in a vacuum, so we are running our lab as a community space where hundreds and hundreds of people of all kinds came through and were using RealTalk for their own projects. And one of our community members here was Sean. So Sean runs a DNA biotechnology lab at UCSF. This is what it looks like. Like any science lab, they depend on computation kind of across the board for all parts of the process, and all that computation has to live in here. So that tiny rectangle is the computational part of the lab, and then here is the rest of the lab. That's where the people are, and that's also where the molecules that they're working with are. They're all in the non-computational part of the lab. So there's this complete disconnect between where the computation is and where it actually needs to be. So Sean and I were both super excited about the prospect of using communal computing to essentially transform the entire scientific process. Molecules and computation could live in the same world, the physical world, and collaborators could learn each other's expertise because all discussions take place around computational models that everybody gets their hands on. So last year we did some initial prototyping, and I'm going to show some clips. This is based on a series of tasks from a real project going on in Sean's lab. We kind of did our own parallel version, RealTalk, off to the side. So here, Sean is typing the name of a protein into a search card, and it's going to bring up the two results from the protein databank. And I'm going to grab the one that we want using this mock test tube. It's kind of like a game piece in a board game. So I pick up that protein, and now it's just sitting out on the table where we both can see it, we can play with it, we can talk about it. I'm going to use this laser pointer to spin the protein around, take a look at it. And for this particular project, we want to create a protein fusion. We want to splice a small protein into this big one. So I'm looking up the small protein from the database, and I'm going to grab the one that I want and move it into the scene. And everything here is multiplayer by default. So you can see we both can play with these proteins at the same time while talking about them. And now to do the splice, I have a splice program. That piece of paper right there is the program. And you can see it's extending a whisker to the left to point to the spot on the protein where we want to splice in the little one. So now we're going to pick up that product in its own test tube, and now it's out on the table where we can take a look at it. And we don't know which of these splices is actually going to work, so we're going to make a bunch of them and just have them lying out on the table. And we're going to organize the ones that we want to make on a mock test tube rack. So this lets us think through the experiment that we're going to do later in the wet lab. And to the right of the test tube rack, you can see a simulated gel. So that's the gel that we would see later on after going through the experiment. Now we want to make some DNA nanostructures for the proteins to bind to. So I swap out the scale bar on the table for a smaller scale bar. And these nanostructures are 3D objects, so we want to build them out of 3D building blocks. So these building blocks represent a layer of 6 DNA helices, and it's 6 turns long, and they snap together at architecturally valid positions. So here, we're literally building a scale model of the nanostructure with our hands, and you can see above, the camera is seeing the structure that we're building and compiling it into the DNA sequence that will fold into this nanostructure. So we build the scale model, and Sean's going to pick up the structure into its own test tube and just have it on the table. And I'm playing with positioning the protein onto the structure to see if it would fit. And now Sean's going to make a variant by sticking a little extra bit on the bottom of that structure. And so now we have a bunch of variant structures just sitting on the table where we can see them and talk about them and simulate them. And one of the important ways that we want to simulate them is to see what they'll look like under the microscope. So now I'm putting this sample on a mock EM grid and firing a mock electron beam at the grid. And now I'm pitting up a program which is going to generate simulated microscope data. So that's what these things would look like under the microscope. And with that simulated data, we can start developing our analysis algorithms that are going to process the data, pick the particles, classify them, and so on. So I'm doing that by just pinning programs up on the board. And this is all live. So you can see here as he rearranges the structure, the entire analysis chain updates live. So you can develop your analysis programs out in the real world where everybody can see it and try out their own thing and argue about it. It's just very different than GitHub. So we've designed our molecules, and now we're going to go to the wet lab to fabricate them. So we put that protocol that we made on the bench, and it prompts for go get these racks and plates, go get these things from the freezer, go fill up these tubes. And now you're going to see that there's a projected line on the lab bench saying pipette from here to here. It says transfer exactly this much liquid from here to here. You can see the entire protocol. It's kind of like turn-by-turn navigation for the wet lab. And then to the right of each test tube, it says exactly what's in that tube and how much at all times. So it's like x-ray vision. You're seeing into the test tubes. Nothing is hidden. So the three main points here. One, molecules and computation live in the same world. Science is about what happens in the physical world. You also need a form of computation, which is also embedded in the physical world. The second point is collaborators learn each other's expertise because all discussions take place with computational models in everyone's hands. So everyone's knowledge gets into everyone's hands. This actually happens. It's kind of uncanny. And the third thing is that this is a completely programmable space where people are constantly making little scratch programs and pointing them at the models on the table. Anything here can be programmed. So even that building block that you saw before, I can just write a little program on that that simulates passivation on the edges. And in fact, this entire set of tools was made in exactly this way. I'm writing the programs out here on the table, right next to the molecules in this totally communal manner. Any of this can be live edited by anybody at any time. What you see on these four posters is the entirety of this set of tools. There is no code base on GitHub. It's just made out of programs that are physically present that everybody can see and get their hands on and change at any time. It's compact enough to imagine a world where scientists make their own tools for themselves and aren't dependent on vendors. So those were just some quick clips, but what Sean and I saw from this prototyping experience was that communal computing could transform every part of the scientific process, from initial conception through experiments to preparing presentations and publications. Every part of that process just seemed ripe for being done communally. And so we feel like the next step is to design a science lab entirely around working in this way, where a culture and community can grow. And we think the best format for doing that is what we're calling a molecular makerspace. So scientists from many different fields will converge to collaborate on projects that they just otherwise would not be able to do, because they need to be working in an environment where they can see what each other's talking about and learn each other's expertise. We think that a lab like this could be the seed of a 21st century way of doing science. And the community that forms around this lab will carry the practices that are developed here gradually into common use. So that's what we're trying to get off the ground right now, and we're looking for funding to make this a reality. Thank you.